All right, folks. God bless you and happy Resurrection Sunday. I'm not going to get into the debates over Sunday, Saturday. It doesn't matter. Happy Resurrection Day. So that's what today represents, the resurrection of Christ and the resurrection of the dead, which is all of us. The Bible says you were dead in your trespasses and sins, but then Christ died for you. And the Bible says He is the resurrection and the life. So Jesus Christ Himself is the resurrection and the life. Do you know why there's a resurrection? I said it like that on purpose. Resurrection. Because there was an insurrection in heaven. And in the insurrection in heaven, what happened was a bunch of angels got kicked out. Let me show you what happened. There was a war in heaven. Michael and his angels fought against the dragon, and the dragon fought and his angels and prevailed not. Neither was there a place found for them anymore in heaven. Now, I'm going to define for you something today that most people have never taken the time just to define. It's so important that you understand the definition of these words and who Satan is. I'm gonna write something on this paper. I'm gonna write what's called the transitive property. If A equals B. So if you have a statement, if A equals B and B equals C. So if A equals B and B equals C, then A equals C. That's called the transitive property. So if A is equal to B and B is equal to C, then it's like, duh, then A is also equal to C because B is equal to C. And A is equal to B, so A is equal to C then. So it's just being able to, transitive property. I'm going to show you the transitive property in the Bible now, which most people have never taken just the 5 minutes to do the simple math on this. Okay, let me show you something. I'm going to teach today about the resurrection, and because there was an insurrection, and I'm going to show you data you've never seen. And I'm going to show you a couple definitions. Here's the word of an insurrection: a violent uprising against authority and government, a rebellion, revolt, uprising, mutiny, insurgence, rising. I like that rising because I keep seeing it everywhere these days, like the Google Doodle, Angelou Jolou, and whatever name, Angela Jolou, Still We Rise. I did a video on that. Remember when it said, even though I have diamonds between my thighs. What the hell? I showed you Debbie Harry. She has an identical likeness of her in a cake with diamonds as her vagina. I mean, it's just a fact. I'm not making this up. I'm just telling you what I've already shown you. Okay, so an insurrection is a rebellion, an uprising. Okay, that's what an insurrection is. And then the resurrection is raising from the dead or restoration to life. Well, imagine if you got kicked out of heaven. And by the way, the Bible says, live out your life as exiles. Okay, so if there was a insurrection and everybody got kicked out and the great dragon was cast out, that old serpent called the devil and Satan, which deceived the whole world, he was cast out into, not on the earth, into the earth, and his angels were cast out with him. Okay? So if there was an insurrection and you were part of that insurrection, I'm just saying, if you were part of an insurrection and you got cast out of your native land, maybe that insurrection was because Lucifer had convinced a bunch of angels it was okay to have a host body system and to have sex and you'll become as gods. No, we can do this. It would be a rising against authority, huh? Well, let's just reason this out. Let's just reason it out. So There was an insurrection in heaven, and the great dragon was cast out, that old serpent called the devil and Satan. He was cast out into the earth, and his angels were cast out with him. Okay, well, insurrection, rebellion, revolt, uprising, mutiny, revolution, insurrection. What does it say? Let me switch places. There was a war in heaven. There was an insurrection. Violent uprising, rioting, rebellion, war. Resurrection, raising from the dead. So let me ask you this. If you got cast out from heaven into a host body system, and that was your punishment, that was your host body was your prison suit, what would that make you? What would that make you? Well, if you get kicked out of anywhere, you're in exile. If you get kicked out of your native country, if your native country was heaven and you were in heaven and you got kicked out and you got kicked out to a place called the earth, then you would be considered an exile because you were kicked out. You're no longer allowed there. Let's type this into Google real quick. Live out your lives as exiles. Exiles. Boom. And the Bible says, so if you call on God, live out your time as your temporary residence on earth in fear, who judges according to every man's work. Pass the time of your exile here in fear. Okay, so we have been, for example, God's people were in exile when they were banished from the garden, lived as slaves in Egypt, carted off to Babylon. So the same as when Jerusalem fell and Nebuchadnezzar took away a bunch of prisoners to Babylon, which means land of confusion. It also means a mixed race. You know what? Let me just show it to you. I'm not just going to say it. I want to prove everything out. I'm gonna be proving everything out today. I've decided just now. I'm not just gonna say it. I'm gonna show it to you in the Bible. So during the time of Jeremiah the prophet, when Nebuchadnezzar sieged Jerusalem, he took away a bunch of captives. What about if Satan seized a bunch of angels, carried them away captive? Would that kind of be the same thing? Let's look at it. Jeremiah the prophet sent from Jerusalem the residue of the elders, which were carried away captives. Let's see. What's the word? Captives. It means to exile. Right there. Same exact word, to exile. But look at the root of the word exile. It means to denude, especially in a disgraceful way. To figuratively to reveal. Well, can you imagine if angels were being led astray by listening to one that was trying to tell them they could do something they shouldn't do? And then you were all found out that that's what you were trying to do and you were cast out. And in a disgraceful way, you were denuded. Did you know the Bible says that in the garden, Adam and Eve were clothed with garments of nakedness? It's a whole different thing, isn't it? Let me show you that, because it's no different than here. So, in the book of Jeremiah, when the people from Jerusalem, which means city of peace, just like, you know, if you're in heaven, you're in a place of peace, but you were carried away captives, so it means to exile, and it means to denude. And it says, again, they were carried away, and to the prophets and to the priests and all the people whom Nebuchadnezzar carried away captive. I want you to look at this word right here, carried away captive. It's not the same word as captives. Captives is 1473. That means exile, so they're exiles. But the root of the word to carried away captive right here is 1540. So let's look at 1540. It means to denude. Do you know why? Do you know why? It's do you know why it is that? Because back in those days, when they would when they would conquer you, if you were conquered, so picture this, Jerusalem, city of peace, conquered and carried away captive, made nude. Oh, like God's angels carried away captive exiles and made nude. Wow, what an interesting, perfect correlation. So the city of peace, Jerusalem, was conquered. There's a lot of them that were conquered, taken away captive, and that means to exile and to denude. So there it is. So let me show you Genesis real quick so you know it's the same exact thing. Genesis 3, what we call the fall. So let me just show you right down here. And it says, and unto Adam and his wife did the Lord God, look, the Lord, the self-existent eternal Jehovah Elohim, make coats of skin and clothe them. Look, coats. It means to cover with a garment, okay? To cover with a garment of skins. It means skin as naked. And look what it means to be bare, to be made naked, to denude. Wow. And he clothed them. And look at that word, to wrap around, to put on a garment. So see, when the Lord God clothed Adam and Eve, he gave them coats to cover, like a shirt or a garment of skins, to be as in naked, and he clothed them to wrap them in a garment of nakedness. So, to be made naked, see? So, they were clothed with nakedness, just the same as the captives from Jerusalem. That's pretty fascinating, isn't it? Now let me go down here and let's define our words. Did you know that in Revelation 9 that we have an angel, the fifth angel sounded, and I saw a star, look, a star fall from heaven unto the earth. It's not a big blazing star or anything, because it says, and to him. See, the star is a him, was to him was given the key to the bottomless pit. And he opened the pit, and there arose smoke out of the pit, as the smoke of a great furnace, and the sun and the air were darkened by reason of the smoke of the pit. And there came out of the smoke locusts upon the earth. And unto them was given power as the power of scorpions. Now look, I'm going to highlight scorpions right there. We'll just do it in like this pink color. Scorpions. To pierce a scorpion from its sting. Okay? Now, I want you to know what the idea of a scorpion is. It means through the idea of concealment, because they're hidden, they're concealed. I'm going to change that color to that. Through the idea of concealment, look, a watch or a sentry. You know what a sentry is? Someone that keeps watch, or a scout. A watch, sentry or scout, because there's a whole above ground race that are the sentries for the scorpions from the pit that are going to come out. So they have their own army above ground that's keeping an eye on everything, leading all the sheep astray into sin, destroying them because we're led to the slaughter all day long. And so, but there's a below ground race that's running that show. Let me show you that real quick and then we'll do our definitions. Let me just show you some little clips from some movies. Now, this is from Time Machine.
Every page of every volume.
Can you tell me what's happening here?
Well, my sources are no longer fully annotated, and my information is somewhat anecdotal. But I believe what was once one race is now two. One above and one below. Two distinct species that have evolved.
And how do those below survive?
That is the real question, isn't it? But I believe what was once one race is now two. One above and one below. Two distinct species that have evolved.
And how do those below survive?
That is the real question, isn't it?
So the race below ground, how do they survive? Well, he winks at the little kid and he bleats like a sheep. They eat sheep. When you wink the eye, the Bible says in John chapter 15, I'm not just going to say it. I'm gonna show you John chapter 15, okay? I'm not just going to say them anymore. I'm just going to make sure you see them with your own eyes. Okay, John chapter 15. This is everything I'm showing you. This is what the Lord has led me to understand, by the way. So anyone that wants to argue with that, go ahead. That's fine. You just have to answer the one that showed it to me. That's all. Okay, so Jesus said, if I had not done the works among them which no other man did, they had not sinned. But now they have both seen and hated both me and my Father. Here it is. But this cometh to pass, that the word might be fulfilled that is written in their law. See, they put themselves under the law through the host body system. They hated me without cause. So Jesus is saying that if he hadn't come and done the works no other man done, they would have no sin. But now that he's come, they're in big trouble. And he said, and this fulfills what is written in their law. They hated me without cause. Now imagine the Almighty God, El, coming into the system to convict all the exiles. Because this is the judgment zone. The earth is the judgment zone. You get a host body for a while, and if you don't get converted, then your judgment, your final solution is carried out. You become food for the angel of the bottomless pit. You go to hell. He gets you. He gets your soul. And they are creating a race of locusts that are going to come out and try and make war against the Lord God. So, El is the Almighty God. That's Hebrew word 4:10. I've shown it to you repetitively. Ezekiel 28, I'll prove it again in just a minute. See, Elohim said, he would rise above the throne of the Most High. Lucifer said, I will rise above the throne of the Most High. The Most High is El, not Elohim. Elohim is Hebrew word 4:30. It means God's angels and magistrates in Genesis 1. It says, let us create man in our vain shell. Because just like the Adidas commercial, I'm going to show you real quick. Just like the Adidas commercial, you know, the original. That's why they have Adidas original commercial, because their race was that upside down race. So here, I'll show it to you. Watch. And Elohim, see the word God right there? That's not the Lord God. That's Elohim. It says it right there. It says Elohim right there. See, Elohim. It says gods that are of, look, the supreme God. So who's the supreme God? I'll show you in just a second. So that gods that are of the supreme God, they're magistrates and they're angels. So gods are magistrates, are angels that are of the supreme God. So they said, let us create man in our vain shell. I mean, it's a phantom that is figuratively an illusion. So what they're saying there right there is that the human host body is really just an illusion. It's just a sham. It's not even real. That's exactly right, because what's going on inside the host body is what's real. The host body system is just a medium for the playing out of the war that's going on. Now watch. So the word image, so Elohim, God's angels, magistrates, said, let us create man in our vain shell. Look. Vain show. That means a fake, a phony. A vain show is a phony. It's a phantom that is figuratively an illusion. Now look at this. Resemblance, hence a representative figure, especially an idol. So no matter what, according to the word of God, the human host body that was created in Genesis 1, no matter what anybody says, is a vain show. It's a phantom. It's an illusion. It's a representative figure. Especially an idol, which it is. Just admit it. The host body's an idol. You know it is. We all know it is. It's vanity, the whole thing. Okay, so let's look at, real quick, I want to show you Ezekiel just to prove it out real quick. Ezekiel 28, so no one can argue with this. You know what? I'll do Isaiah first. I'll do Isaiah 14, then Ezekiel. Isaiah 14. For the Lord will have mercy on Jacob. It means the supplanter. By the way, we are Jacob because we supplant the race that was already here. And yet we'll choose Israel. Let me show you what Israel means. Yisrael. Let's break down the word. Yisra means he will rule as, and then the word El is Hebrew word for 10. See, look, El, see, it means the Almighty God. See, the Almighty, right there. I'm going to do that pink so it totally stands out. See, the Almighty, it means the Almighty, but let me show you the root of the word. It means a chief politically, also a ram. You know, like a ram, because the Lord God is referred to many times as a sheep, the sheep that was led to the sacrificial lamb. So that is a representation of him being a chief politically. What happened in heaven now? There was an insurrection. There was a rebellion, an uprising, a revolt. Against who was the uprising and revolt against? Well, the chief politically, which is a ram. But then when we go back, it's the Almighty God, El. See, Hebrew word for 10. And then the Bible tells us that there will be a sign given unto us in Isaiah 7 that a virgin shall conceive. A virgin shall conceive and bring forth a son, and you shall call his name Emmanuel. See, I changed the color there for the word Emmanuel. Let's look at that. Emmanuel, what it means. Emmanuel means with us is. I'm going to change the color of that to pink. With us is, I'm going to change that to yellow. With us is God. Well, what's the word for God? Let's click on it. Hebrew word for 10. The Almighty. Oh, the ram. So there it is. So a virgin shall bring, conceive, and bear a son, and you shall call his name. With us is the Almighty God. And see, it means with us is God. Hebrew word for 10. So with us is El, the Almighty God. So no one can argue with what I just showed you. I just showed you absolute perfection in Bible. So Jesus is the Almighty God that came. With us is El. Why do you think Elohim hates him? Oh, because he came into their system that was their little playground, and they are in deep shit. Excuse me for that, but I just want to make a point. Why do you think they hate him? What do they think? What do you think they hate Jesus and his father? Because Jesus is the father. And he's here to convict them. That's why he did the works no other man did. And if he had not done those works, they would have no sin. But now they have no excuse for their sin because they know that the boss was among them. And they crucified the boss. And the crucifixion of Christ, which is what we're celebrating today, the resurrection, the resurrection is for all the rebels like myself that admitted I was guilty. I said I was sorry. I said I deserved to go to hell and he would be just in condemning me. I literally said that in my living room. And what I said was, I said, you know what? I've done everything my way. I got everything I wanted. It's not what I want. And there's nothing I can do to fix it. I deserve to go to hell. That's exactly what I said. I mean, when I say exactly, those are the words. That's the conversation I had with the Lord God right before I got saved in my living room. I said that. I deserve to go to hell. You'd be just in condemning me. I just admitted my guilt. And then I said, you know, the world doesn't make any sense anymore. Nothing makes sense. I know Jesus is real. I just don't know which one he is, because the Mormons have their own Jesus, the Jehovah's Witnesses, the Baptists, the Presbyterians, you know, the Catholics. Everyone's got their own version. They can't all be right. That's what I said. I'm like, they can't all be right. I just want to know the truth. That's exactly what I said. I just want to know the truth, because nothing makes sense. Oh, Jesus is the truth. And that he is the spirit of all truth. Did y'all know that? Jesus is the spirit of all truth. And when the spirit of truth comes into you, he will teach you all things. Who do you think taught me? I didn't learn the Bible from any man. You know, all these false prophet hunters, they're doomed. They're all going to burn. Because if I'm speaking and I'm showing you supernatural things via the Holy Spirit, that means they spoke evil of the Holy Spirit. They attributed the supernatural gifts I have to an evil source. And that's blasphemy, which means speaking evil of the Holy Spirit. So God have mercy on them. I feel sorry for them. I'm not mad at them. I'm like, you freaking idiots. Dude, keep your mouth shut. Don't condemn yourself. You know, call me in four-letter word or something, but don't attribute the supernatural revelation of the Bible itself, the Word of God, to a demonic source. Then you blaspheme the Holy Spirit. Let me show you what the Holy Spirit says. Let me show you what the Bible says. You need not that anyone teach you what is true, for the Spirit himself, it's a him, by the way, will teach you all things. Boom. John, 1 John 2:27, okay? So let's go to 1 John 2:27. We're going to do a Bible study today, and we're going to do unbelievable supernatural data. 1 John 2, I think that's right. 1 John 2. 1 John 2:23. Hang on. Let me go back. Sorry. 1 John 2:27. There we go. Yeah, so I was anointed in the alley the night I got saved. And that's what happened. That's what taught me everything I've shown you. But the anointing which you have received of him abideth in you. See? And ye need not that any man teach you. But as the same anointing teacheth you of all things and is truth and is no lie. Now think about the night I got saved. When the Lord told me, read the tags in the clothes you're carrying, Jonathan. And I read that first tag and it said 100% nylon. Like, what the hell? 100% nylon. That I said, that doesn't make any sense. And the Lord said, turn it upside down. And I read it backwards and upside down. 100% no lying, N-O-L-Y-N. Like a Texan would say, hey, don't be lying to me. And I read 100% no lying. And my whole body just like supernaturally just, I was like, what is going on? Well, that was the Spirit telling me, you got it, buddy. To see the truth, you got to turn everything upside down. If you want to see the truth, because nylon doesn't make any sense. But if you turn it upside down, 100% no line is also 100% truth, isn't it? Yeah. So anyway, that was the Spirit communicating with me in a supernatural, very interesting way. So, but the same anointing teaches you all things in his truth and is no lie, even as it hath taught you, ye shall abide in him. So there we go. So we know that the Spirit himself will teach you all things, which is the truth. And see, Jesus is this, like, the anointing which you see of him, the abideth in you. So that's the Holy Spirit in you. And it teaches you all truth. Do you see what I mean? So the Spirit of Christ is the Spirit of all truth that teaches you all things that are true. And we're going to get into like so much data today and what happened over in Sri Lanka and all that. Y'all are going to freak out. Y'all are going to be like, oh my Lord. You want to see truth? You want to see some truth today where you're just like, that's unbelievable. Just stick around. We're going to do it all. We're going to have a great day. So anyway, I'm just going to share with you what I know. Okay, now we're going to go back to the Bible. Okay, so the virgin shall bring forth a son, and you shall call his name Emmanuel. See? And you click on Emmanuel, and it says, with us is, see, Emmanu right there. With us is, I'm going to highlight that pink. The word, part of the word Emmanu, see right here, Emmanu, Imanu. That part, that means with us is. And see the little EL right there? That's Hebrew word 410. With us is L. See, because Hebrew word 410 is EL. And it's pronounced A-L-E, like, you know, having a drink of L. So there it is, L. And L means the Almighty God. So if you go back to Genesis 1, I'm just going to prove it out again. The original here, when it says God created the heaven and the earth, look, that's not El, that's Elohim, gods of the Supreme God, because this was their escape that they wanted from. They're like, we want to do our own thing, and the Lord God's like, okay, but I'm gonna caveat this right now. Now the Lord God is in control of all things, so He allowed that. They're like subcontractors working for a general contractor that stole all the stuff that didn't belong to them. He's like, all right. And the stuff that didn't belong to him were a bunch of God's angels that they deceived and led away captive into the land of Babylon. Let's go back and let's prove out real quick. I'm going to prove everything out using the Bible today so none of the heretics can say Kleck's a false prophet. Bring your scriptures and come up against me. Don't come up against me with your little lies. So look, Jeremiah the prophet and all the people that were carried away captives, see, exiles, and the Bible says, what? Here it is. The Bible says, live out your life, pass the time of your exile here in fear. So we're the exiles, no doubt about it. Okay, so now let's go back down to here. So the residue of the elders which were carried away captives, exiled, and the priests and to the prophets and to all the people, like all the people, as a congregated unit, as a tribe of those of Israel, look, figuratively a flock. So picture a big flock getting carried away from the city of peace and they're carried away, and what's their punishment? They're made naked. See? They're made naked in a disgraceful way. Because back in those days, what they used to do is they used to march them through the street. They'd strip them down naked and march all the prisoners into their new land, you know, their new home, Babylon, naked. Now watch. Okay, look at the word Babylon. See, it says confusion. So they were led away from the city of peace into the land of confusion. That's what Babylon means. And it means to overflow. Remember, like Flo, the girl on the progressive commercials, and they're going and putting those signs with the scorpion tails in everybody's yard that's dressed in white like sperm? Yeah. So look, to overflow, specifically with oil, by implication, to mix, to mingle self. Oh, wow. So now they're getting carried away into a land of confusion where they're overflowing, mingling self. Oh, kind of like, oh, just like it says, a mixed race. Wow. It's pretty amazing, isn't it? Look how perfect the Word of God is. Now, let's go back to Isaiah again. So let me teach you again. Let me just show you what the Lord's shown me. I'll share it with you. So Isaiah, we know that you shall call his name Emmanuel, which means with us is the Almighty God. See, with us is the Almighty God. But let's go find a scripture where we see that Lucifer is something totally different than El, the Almighty God. Let's find a scripture where we can look at Lucifer and his association with the word God, and what that juxtaposition is with the word El. Let's do that. That way we can definitively outline. And then we're going to come back to this, which is what I started with. We're going to come back and use a transitive property, and we're just going to destroy Satan's kingdom today. All right? Okay, for the Lord, the self-existent eternal Jehovah, will have mercy on Jacob. Jacob means supplanter, because when I got born again, I became a supplanter. I was born into Satan's kingdom as a child of the devil, but then I got converted, so I became a supplanter. Now remember, Jacob changed his name. The Lord changed Jacob's name to Israel after he struggled with God, which is what we all do. We get converted, we struggle with God, and he refines us. And so Jacob became Yisrael. Now, look what Israel means. Yisra means, see Yisra right there? Y-I-S-R-A. Yisra means he will rule as, and then El, God, the Almighty God. See, this is all perfection in delivery of scripture now. The scriptures are perfect. Now, let's look down here at when Lucifer falls. How art thou fallen? See the word Nephalic. I want you to say this word out loud. Nephal, N-A-P-H-A-L, and it's pronounced Nephal. Okay, look what it says. To fall, to cast down. Look at the colors. Cast is in green, down is in yellow, and I outlined out in blue. So it means to cast down, to cast self, to cast out. It means to divide, be judged, fugitive. So you know what a fugitive is? You know, somebody that's on the run trying not to get in trouble. Well, you know, when Jesus said Emmanuel came into their system and he said, if I hadn't done the works no other man did, they would have no sin. But now they have both hated both me and my father, bringing to pass what is written in their law. They hated me without cause. I showed it to you in John 15. Well, let me show it. Look right here. John 15. See, they hated me without cause. Well, he was quoting their law. See, he says that the word might be fulfilled that is written in their law. They hated me without cause. Well, did you know he was quoting, watch. So we're in John 15, but Jesus was quoting Psalm 35. And let me watch Psalm 35 says, 35:19. It says, let not them that are my enemies wrongfully rejoice over me, neither let them wink with the eye that hate me without a cause.
That is the real question, isn't it? That I've evolved.
And how do those below survive?
That is the real question, isn't it?
Wow. He winks his eye. He winks his eye.
That is the real question, isn't it?
See? So when you wink your eye, and someone winks their eye at you, you know that the other side, you know, the side of evil, realm of darkness from the other side is looking right at you. And when I walked into Starbucks and a guy named Alex is like, hey, Johnny, how you doing? He's pointing his finger like a scorpion stinger at it. Hey, Johnny, how you doing? You know, when someone shoots a bird, it's a scorpion stinger. See the ball? Yeah. It's a no-brainer now. I've got their whole language figured out. I'm just telling you. This is what the Lord showed me. I'm just giving it to you. So the guy winks his eye, and he said, how do the ones below ground survive? Well, that's the real question. And he sticks out his tongue, and he winks his eye. Well, you know, that's kind of wild because the largest church in the world is a sheep with its tongue sticking out. Huh. So, and look, here's this girl from a modeling company called V-Files, and she's got one eye closed and her tongue sticking out, just like Alex. That's funny. She's a girl, right? What happens when you turn an image of the Virgin upside down? It's a sheep with its tongue sticking out, just like this sheep. So, we have a common denominator. Look at Marilyn Manson with one eye showing and his tongue sticking out. So that would mean that Marilyn Manson and anyone that does it is the other side is working through that host body system. You understand? They're just a slave to it. And God have mercy on them. They've been taken captive completely. They're not looking like they have a chance at all because they're winking their eyes, sticking out their tongue. Well, remember the kid Alex when I walked into Starbucks? Hey, Johnny, how's it going? He would wink his eye, stick out his tongue, which is Isaiah 57 verse 4, and he would stick out his tongue, and then he would point his finger, and I know that what that means now. It's a scorpion stinger. And so he would do all those little, mannerisms, And I knew that by the what he was doing, what was coming through him. And so let me show you what it says in the Bible. Hang on. Isaiah 57 verse 4, not 54, 57 verse 4. So, draw here near hither, you sons of the sorceress, the female, that's a sorceress, it's female, the seed of the adulterer and the whore. Against whom do you sport yourself and make a wide mouth and stick out your tongue, draw out your tongue? Are you not children of transgression, a seed of falsehood? So see, there it is. I mean, you know, why do you think they're sticking their tongues out? I mean, why do you think this girl's got her eye closed? Well, that's what the Bible says. They hated me without cause because they're the seed of falsehood. And they're mocking you. Against whom do you sport yourself and stick out your... That's why it's V-files, because I told you. They love the VV system. Why do you think someone's going, hey, peace, man, you go peace back? Get it? Five and five, Roman numeral five, Roman numeral five. And when you put them together, it makes a letter called a W. And they love using that because it means a good you and a bad you. A double you, five and five. You're half and half. Half one thing, half something else. Two different species in one host body system. Pretty wild, right? Let's keep going. Okay, well, so let's go back down here. Let's prove out what I was saying. How art thou fallen from heaven? See, O Lucifer, son of the morning, how art thou cut down to the ground, which didst weaken the nations, a foreign nation or flight of locusts? Wow. For thou hast said in thine heart, I will ascend into heaven. I will exalt my throne above the stars. Look at that, a prince. It means as round and shining, because God's princes are light beings, as round and shining. We're talking like light beings. I will ascend above the stars, the princes of heaven. The stars of God, I'm sorry. I will exalt my throne above the stars, the princes of, look, of who? The princes of who? The Almighty God, which is, Jesus is Emmanuel. So who is the Almighty God? So Lucifer is going to, he's going to set his heart to ascend into heaven. I will exalt my throne above the princes of El. Right there, see? And who is Jesus? I want to reiterate this. Jesus is Emmanuel. With us is the Almighty God, came into the system via virgin, walked around in a host body, it was sinless, died on the cross to get the prisoners back that were taken captive that belonged to him. He's here to set the captives free. Did you know that? Did you know the Bible says, I have come to set the captives free? Yeah, let's look. Watch, two scriptures. So let's do this. I'll just do this real quick. I'm going to knock down some of these windows. Okay, so here we go. I have come to set the captives free. Okay, so it should be Luke 4 and Isaiah 61. Okay, so let's go to Isaiah 61 first, okay? So we already know right now that Lucifer said in his heart, I will set my throne above the stars of El. Right there, Jesus is Emmanuel. See, so the Lord God that came in the flesh, that's Emmanuel. That's El walking around. That's who it is. It's El. El is walking around doing the works no other man's done. Why do you think when the Holy Spirit comes into one of us, we're able to do the works other men can't do? The Lord's had me lay hands on. Guys, I'm not trying to take any credit for this, because I'm a pathetic sinner that was saved by the grace of God. He's had me lay hands on someone that was blind in one eye, right in front of this house. It's on YouTube. His name was Juan Longoria. I'd only met him four times, and he was out front telling me all his problems and that he thought maybe God was trying to talk to him. And I told him, I said, well, maybe God is trying to talk to you, Juan. And he said, yeah, I got all these problems, you know, my wife and this, and everybody lies. I hate lies. I'm blind in my eye. And right then I heard the Lord say, lay hands on Juan. I'm going to heal his eye. I was like, awkward. I looked at Juan and I said, hey, Juan, I'm going to lay hands on you. And he didn't know what that meant. He looked at me like it was some weird, come on, you know. He's like, and I was like, no, I'm going to lay hands on you. The Lord's going to heal your eye. Yeah. And I, you know, it was very, you know, it was weird. I'm just going to be honest. It was kind of awkward. So I laid hands on Juan and I held him. I said, in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, Heavenly Father God, restore Juan's sight. And right after I did it, I was like, I looked at him and I said, well, I couldn't believe what came out of my mouth, actually. I looked at him and I go, don't worry, it'll come. And as soon as I said those words, I was like, oh my gosh, I can't believe I said that. What am I saying? Have I lost my mind? And it was, you know, it was weird. And so we walked around the house and we crawled in a tunnel under the house. We're doing some plumbing. We had a tunnel dug under this whole house. We crawled through the tunnel and I heard this guy go, hey, dog. He was crawling behind me. We had headlights on. And he goes, hey, dog. And I'm like, what? And I was crawling through mud and waters. He said, hey, dog, man. And I'm like, what's up, dude? He's like, you're not going to believe me. And he put his hand over his good eye. He goes, I can see. Did you know that when you get surgery on your eye, the doctor takes off the bandages in the dark? Isn't it fascinating? He was in a tunnel in the dark under this house when his eyesight came back in an eye that was blind. It's just unbelievable. But see, the Holy Spirit is El. It's a spirit of the Almighty God and the spirit of all truth. And when that comes into a human being, that spirit can do the same works through that human being. That's why the Lord's had me lay hands on the blind. He's had lay hands on people that had incurable eye problems. He had me lay hands on someone that had cancer. I didn't even know where they were sick. And he told me, go lay hands on Mark the waiter. I'm like, what? Yep. And I walked over to Mark. I said, Mark, I'm sorry I got to do this. And I just put in one here. And I said, in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, Heavenly Father God, restore Mark's health. I didn't know he was sick. It was really weird. I was like, and I looked at Mark. I was like, and Mark's like, thanks, John. It was really awkward. And I was just like, yeah, I'm going to go over there and, yeah, drink my coffee. I'll see you later. It was super awkward. I went back in there, you know, maybe a week and a half, 2 weeks later, and I was drinking my coffee, and Mark came up. He's like, John, how did you know? How did you know? And I'm looking up, drinking my coffee, like going, know what? How did you know? Oh, my God, I had colon cancer, and I went to University Hospital, and they were trying to decide on my course of treatment. I went back after you prayed over me, and it's gone. They can't even find it. They can't even find it. I was like, I was probably more shocked than he was. I was like, you're kidding me. I was like, there's no way. Yeah, but I didn't know he had colon cancer. The Lord just told me to lay hands on that guy, and I was obedient. Okay, so anyway, the Holy Spirit is the spirit of the Almighty God. That's why Jesus was the Holy Spirit in the flesh. So we're talking about Resurrection Sunday today, Resurrection Day. We'll just call it Resurrection Day. There was an insurrection. Everybody got carried away off to Babylon, mixed race, land of confusion. And then God pulls out of here the ones that were predestined to get to go back home because your sentence gets commuted and the two get made whole into one. That's why Jesus was crucified between two different guys, you know, a good one and a bad one, Justus and Decimus. One guy admitted his guilt, said, I deserve it, like Jonathan Kleck did in his living room. I deserve my punishment. I deserve hell. And one guy, Justus and Decimus. And see, a good and a bad. And he's reaching out to both sides. Ephesians 2, his purpose is to make one new man from the two. You're two different things. You're good and bad. You are the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. Right side up, upside down. Light, dark. Okay, let's go back to Isaiah 61. So let's go to Isaiah 61 and see what Jesus' mission was, because I mean, you know, this is pretty important. So The Spirit of the Lord God is upon me because the Lord hath anointed. Okay, so look at this. The Spirit, okay, of the Lord. Look, the word Lord here is not the self-existent eternal Jehovah. It means Lord as a proper name of God only, like my Lord. But look at the word God right here. It's a self-existent eternal Jehovah, because even though it's, I want to show you something. See, it's H, Hebrew word 3069. Well, Hebrew word 3069 is the way you use it in the sentence Yehovah, but it's from the root Jehovah, which means the self-existent eternal Jehovah. So this is the Lord, as in my Lord, self-existent Jehovah is upon me because the Lord hath anointed me, look, to consecrate, to appoint. That's what he did to me. He anointed me in the alley the night I got saved. He has anointed me to preach good tidings to the meek. He has sent me to bind up the brokenhearted and to proclaim liberty, meaning to move rapidly, spontaneity, outflow, liberty of the captives, those that were transported into captivity, to bring away, carry away, lead away, take captive. So, by definition of this scripture, we were carried away captive from where? Do you think everybody was in Babylon? You know, we're all in Jerusalem back in the day. No, we're in the heavenly Jerusalem, city of peace, and we were led away captive here. We're in mystery Babylon right now. So see, we were led away captive. So he came to proclaim liberty to the captives. Okay, look at this. And the opening of the prison. Isn't that interesting? And the opening of the prison. It's all one thing with one word attached. Oh, it means redoubled. Oh, wow. So the two are made one. Opening of a dungeon. Delivery. But look what it says. Redoubled. And it means to open. Okay. But so, the opening of the prison means redoubled. So the two come together as one. So, and redoubled opening of a dungeon, delivery, figuratively salvation from sin to them that are bound. Oh, look, to yoke or hitch, to fasten, to join in battle. Because, see, you were fastened together with the demon inside your host body. I've shown you all these images that prove it. I'm going to show them to you again, and I'll refer to this when I show you the image. But remember what I showed you right here. Because he's going to open the prison, the opening of a dungeon, by redoubling, making you whole again, to the prison then those that were bound, to yoke or hitch, to a, like a demon, to fasten in any sense, to join in battle, just like Babylon, mixed race. Okay? To proclaim the acceptable year of the Lord and the day of vengeance, which revenge, to take vengeance, to punish. So anyway, that's pretty heavy stuff, right? Well, let's look at when Jesus said it. So let's go to, okay, so right here, we're going to go to Luke 4:18 now. So let's go to Luke 4:18. Okay, so here we go. Luke, New Testament. Luke 4, verse 18. We're going to look at that same scripture, but in Luke. Because, see, Jesus, he stepped up in the synagogue and he began to read. You know, he steps up. He opens the scroll. You know, when you open a scroll, you go like this, right side up, upside down at the same time. So he opens the scroll in front of all the Pharisees. Can you imagine those guys and what they were like? What? Can you imagine the looks on their face? When he tells them, today in your hearing, the scriptures are fulfilled. Did they all like, what? Did he do? Can you imagine all the Pharisees? all the fake religious phonies. I see those guys every day. They have their channels. They think they have, they think they're bringing the Bible. No, they're not. They're ministers of lies. They don't know the truth. I mean, look at the truth that's been delivered so far today. scriptural. You can call me a false prophet all day long. It just puts you in the pit. But when you do it, try and come with some scripture instead of some video where you're playing like rock music. Clicks of false prophet. I see these guys. They do a video where they're playing like heavy metal music. Clicks of false prophet. It's like, dude, what the hell? Come with some scriptures or something. You know, show us. Show us. Bring your witnesses. I'm a witness for the Lord God. Bring your witnesses. Come on, let's do it. Show me your scriptures that prove it. Okay, so, and there was delivered unto him the book of the prophet Isaiah. So let's look at the delivered. To give, to hand over, to deliver unto you. The book, it's the scroll, because the open scroll of the prophet Isaiah. And we just read what the prophet Isaiah said. And he opened the book. Oh, so when Jesus comes in the sense of reversal, because Jesus himself is the reversal of the system you got caught in. He's the reversal of the host body snare. The host body snare is in opposition to the Spirit of God. Go read Romans. The flesh is contrary to the Spirit. The flesh is in opposition. If you live according to the flesh, you will die, for the lusts of the flesh mean death. If you live according to the carnal mind, you're dead. Right. The flesh is in opposition to the Spirit. So when Jesus opens the book, do you understand how profound this is? It means open means reversal, because he's opening the meaning of the Word of God. And when he had opened in the sense of reversal, now I want you to see the root of this word, because this has everything to do with my ministry. I'm repetitive on purpose because the Lord made me that way. And everything I show you to open the door, I show you got to reverse it. Like you got to turn the image of the virgin upside down to see the dead sheep. And you're the dead sheep. Oh, so the virgin equals dead sheep. The having sex with the virgin equals the dead sheep. Yes. Yes. Watch. So what's the word in the sense of reversal? What's the root of the word? The Jonathan Kleck scripture. The word is Anna. Properly up. Because see, you're all upside down. You just got to get turned right side up. So properly up, repetition like Jonathan does, it drives us crazy. Intensity, hang on. And reversal. Okay, there you go, reversal. So even Jesus, when he opened the book, it means in the sense of reversal, he reversed your judgment. And the root of that word is up. Like seven up. See, you remember I showed you the seven up? Seven up. They hate those of us that are turned right side up. So seven means to destroy. Seven up. Destroy those that are up. I'm up. So I'm marked for destruction. It's like, good. Bring it. I don't care. We just took over your whole deal, Satan. We just destroyed you. And I'm living proof of it. There you go. So see, Jesus, when he opened the scroll, the word opened in the sense of reversal, because the Bible has been hidden from everybody. The Word of God, the only way you can understand the Bible is if you have the Spirit inside you, the Spirit of all truth, which sees with spiritual eyes of truth. That's why all these, again, these crazy people that do these false prophet, it's like, okay. I'll tell you what, I'll concede to every false prophet hunter. If I'm a false prophet, I will gladly, absolutely go into the pit. I'm down with that. I'm good with it. I deserve it. If I'm a false prophet, I deserve to be in the pit. But if you're wrong, then you deserve eternal damnation yourself, don't you? I mean, that's just tit for tat, right? I'm okay with that. But we'll see what happens. I mean, one of us is going to go into the pit, right? I'm okay with that. Okay, so he opened the book, and he found the place where it was written. The Spirit, look at the word Spirit. The word is pneuma, pneuma. Now, this is where we're going to do a quick five-minute Bible study so you understand. You are not born with the Holy Spirit. You have to be born again. You are born with a superhuman angel demon spirit. The spirit at work in the children of disobedience. But when you get born of the Holy Spirit, you get born again. And the two become one, and your sentence is reversed. You're not opposing yourself. You're in concert with yourself. The two that are in opposition became one, and you're no longer at odds with yourself. Oh, you don't have to fight yourself anymore because you're caught in a dualistic system, right? So here we go. So the spirit, look at the word spirit. It's pneuma. It's word 4151. It means current of air. That is blast or breath of air. It means superhuman and angel demon right there. And I'm going to change the color to blue. Superhuman angel demon. Look at the word or. I'm going to put a little more yellow in there to so you can see it. So superhuman angel demon. I'm going to highlight that a little better. So superhuman and angel demon. So a superhuman is an angel demon or divine God, Christ spirit, the Holy Spirit. I think I'll change this color to green just to make it there. So you're either a superhuman, which is an angel demon, or you're divine, God, Christ, Holy. You're one or the other. Well, which do you think Jesus was? An angel demon or divine God, Christ, Holy Spirit? Obviously, he's that one. So the spirit of the Lord, the controller, Kurios, master, is upon me because he has anointed me to preach gospel to the poor, a beggar, because we are beggars. We have nothing anymore. We lost everything. We're beggars now. And he has sent me to heal, look what it says, make whole. See, I'm not making, look, let me ask you a question, guys. Have you seen anything yet that's not absolute perfection in scriptures? No. This is perfection because the spirit of all truth is in me. And the spirit of truth is what's laying this out for you. Not me. Jonathan Kleck is, I'm just part of what's happening. The spirit is what's discerning this, not me. That's why if you call me a false prophet, you just, again, you spoke evil of the Holy Spirit. So he came to heal the brokenhearted. Brokenhearted, that means to crush completely, to shatter. Okay, bruise. And to preach, to herald as a public crier. Okay, especially of divine truth. I'm going to highlight this all blue. I want to show you something. So Jesus's ministry was to heal the brokenhearted. He has sent me to heal the brokenhearted, to make whole. And he has sent me to preach. Okay, preach, look, as a public crier, the truth. Now, I'm just gonna do this real quick. I'm gonna go to an album. Let's see. Let me go to another album real quick. Okay. I want to show you something because this is unbelievable. I think you should see this. Because Jesus said his ministry was this. He took up the ministry that was outlined in Isaiah. And I'm gonna show you something very strange. Okay, so let me see if I can get it on the first one. I don't really want to have to hunt around, but we'll see where it is. Let's see. Let's see if it's in this folder. If it's not, I know the folder it's in, but hopefully it's in here. Nope. Let me go back. There you go. Just give me one sec. Just bear with me for a second. We're just hanging out. This is going to be amazing delivery of information all day. I still haven't even gotten into the stuff yet. Let me see. Okay, here we go. Personal testimony. Here we go. Personal testimony. Let me just show you something because you tell me what you think the odds are. Okay, so let me show you what the name Jonathan means. So Jonathan means God has given. It means Yahweh has given. Okay, now the name Jonathan is symbolic of extreme devotion because Jonathan was extremely devoted to King David. Even though Jonathan knew he was in line for the throne from Saul, he said, no, I know that God wants David to have it. And he was a loyal to death, loyal, steadfast friendship. That's what Jonathan is a symbol of. Now, I'm a loyal, steadfast friend to Jesus because of what he did for me. And let me show you what Jonathan means. Jonathan means God is given. And it says, it's the same elements of the name Matthew, but in reverse order. This is the name of several characters in the Bible, most notably the son of King Saul, who was a devoted friend and supporter of young David. Okay, the name is taken symbolic, steadfast friendship, loyalty. That's what it means. And guys, I'll just be honest. I have been steadfast in to Jesus since I got saved, because there's been so many times where it's just been like, I don't want to do this anymore. But I keep going. Now, let me show you what Kleck means. Here you go. So Kleck, right here, Kleck, German variant of clock, K-L-O-C-K. It says C-Glock. So when you type in the meaning of Jonathan Kleck, this is what it brings up. Kleck means, it's from German high middle Glock, apparently ultimate Celtic source. Topographical name for someone who lived by the bell tower of a church. So what did they do? Well, a habitational name from distinguished by the sign of a bell, or a metonymic occupational name from a sexton who, among other duties, was responsible for ringing the church bell, you know, to gather the church, or a town crier who used a handbell to draw attention. So let me show you that. So a town crier. Okay, so Jesus said, I've come to heal the brokenhearted and to preach, and look at the word preach, as a public crier of divine truth. Well, what is the divine truth that I'm preaching? You're upside down. You need to get turned up. You need to get turned up. You're upside down. You're born into a host body that's contrary and opposed to the Spirit of the living God. So you got to be born from a supernatural angel demon into the Holy Spirit. So the word spirit is either, I'm going to show you what you are before you get saved, in Ephesians 2 right here, in Ephesians 2, wherein in time past you walked according to the course of this world, according to the prince of the power of the air. See, the prince of the power of the air, which is Satan. Who's that? He's the spirit that worketh in the children of disobedience. Look, fulfilling the lusts of the flesh and the desires of the flesh, and were by nature children of wrath. See, because the flesh, which is upside down to the Spirit of God, makes you a child of wrath. So look at this. The prince of the power of the air, which is the spirit. Let's look at that word. Oh my God, it's 4151. Pneuma. Oh, it's a superhuman angel demon. It's a superhuman angel demon spirit, which is really fascinating, because I can show you a guy that's got a tattoo on his back of a sheep, which is what their job is, to kill sheep. And that guy with the sheep tattoo on the middle of his back right here. See, let me show you the sheep. See, what you look at, did you see a sheep right here? Let me just show it to you. Did you see a sheep right here? Well, I saw the sheep. I saw an angel demon linked together. I saw a penis and testicles. I saw an entity sucking up the souls of the whole system. Let's see. There you go. So here's an angel that's trapped. See the angel? Here's an image of a devil with a horn right here. An angel and a demon. Here's this guy with half of his face cloaked right here. But did you see that the whole thing's a sheep? This is the eye of the sheep. There's the ear of the sheep. There's the ear of the sheep. Here's the nostril of the sheep. There's the lip of the sheep. There's under the chin of the sheep. See, the Lord God gave me the ability to see way past what's normal. As a matter of fact, it's not normal. It's not natural. It's supernatural. That's how you know the Spirit of truth is working through me. Because either you're a supernatural angel demon. Oh, that's what's on that guy's tattoo, an angel demon. So his heart's divided. It's an angel and a demon. And that whole thing is a human heart. Let me show you. Yeah, the whole thing's a heart. Let me show you all those constituent parts. Let me break it down for you. So now if you just look at the whole thing in red, see, it's a human heart. That whole thing's a heart. Well, let me show you a couple different faces that you may or you may not have seen. The whole thing's a sheep. So I'll take this sheep and I'll put it right here. Here's the sheep right here. And I put it right here just so you can see the general disposition of the sheep right here. See, there's the eye of the sheep right there. This is the ear of the sheep. It also becomes a penis and testicles. Here's the other ear. Here's the see the nostril, and there's a line in the lip. So here's the snoot of the sheep, just like, see the snoot of the sheep right here? The snoot of the sheep right here. Going up the face of the sheep right here. Going up the face, what do you come to? The eye. So what do you come to? The eye. Coming up to the eye. What's over here? There's the ear. There's the ear of the sheep. So this guy's got a big dead sheep on his back. But wait a minute. It's not just a dead sheep. It's an angel that's trapped and a demon. Wait a minute. What does Ephesians 2 says? So the prince of the power of the air, the spirit, superhuman and angel demon. So this guy just happens to have an angel and a demon in a heart. Oh, Jesus came to bind up the brokenhearted, shattered. See, your heart's divided. You're an angel and a demon, one heart. Let's take a look at that. Earpiece. Oh, that's a penis and testicles, isn't it? Sure is. Wow. Let's turn that thing upside down. You see the eye there and the eye there and the open mouth. Look where all the energy's going in the mouth of the worm that never dies. You see. So anyway, so I'm just taking scriptures and proving out my point over and over and over again, because the Bible's perfect. It's perfection. That's why they want to do away with the truth. Okay, so now, so Jesus came to bind up the brokenhearted, to set the captives free, Luke 4. He came to heal the brokenhearted, to preach as a town crier, divine truth, deliverance. It literally means, by the way, it means to turn up. Look, he has anointed me to preach the gospel to the poor, beggar, and sent me to set apart, set at liberty, to heal, to make whole the brokenhearted whose hearts were divided, and to preach as a herald or a town crier of divine truth, deliverance, freedom, forgiveness of sins, pardon to the captives. Oh, look at the word captives, a spear, a prisoner of war. Wow, we're a prisoner of war. And the recovering of sight, the restoration of sight to the blind, and to set at liberty forgiveness those that were bruised, crushed. There it is. And when he opened the book, the sense of reversal, and it literally means up, properly up. That's why there's a drink literally called 7-Up, because I know their playbook now. It's like I took their coach's playbook. The number 7, I'll just show it to you. You know what? Let me show you the number 7. Instead of me talking to you, I'll show you the number 7. Ready? STRON Strong's 7. See, they're claiming to be the God of this world. Strong 7 means to perish, to destroy. See, so look. So to perish. Ready? Strong 7, it means to perish, to destroy. I don't know what happened here. I'm trying to open it real quick. Uh-oh. That's weird. I'll go back here and I'll go back. Strong's 7. See, okay, strong 7. It means to perish. Right there. To perish, to destroy. I don't want to click on it because I don't want it. Well, I'll go ahead and try it, see what happens. Yep. That's pretty weird. So now it looks like maybe I'm getting some kind of an attack. So anyway, Strong's, I have another place it's written right here. So I'll just go down right here and show you 7-Up. See, 7-Up is a scorpion stinger. Look, see the scorpion stinger? That's a stinger delivering poison. Okay, well, they put up on there because we're the ones that have been turned up. See, you're in Satan's world. So that 7-Up machine you're looking at, it belongs to Satan. The guy that makes 7-Up belongs to Satan. 7 means to perish, to destroy those that are up, which I'm one of those. So I'm marked for destruction. See, look, to perish, destroy, destroyed, perish. So just like it says in here, and when he opened the book to those that have eyes to see in the sense of reversal, properly up. So they kill, they destroy those that have been turned up in their system. That's why they kill Christians, because we're the ones that have turned the world upside down in their world. And like, oh crap, they're going to get the word out, kill them. What do you think they kill the prophets? I mean, come on. It's a no-brainer. It's what they do. They kill you. That's what they try to. But nothing happens unless God allows it. So, okay, so there we go. So now I'm going to go back to here. Okay, so now, again, today is the day we celebrate the resurrection, the raising from the dead, because the Bible says you're dead in your sins and trespasses. So when you're born dead. That's why the Bible says, arise, O sleeper, wake up from the dead, and Christ will give you light. You see all the perfection going on here in Scripture all of a sudden? It's because once you have the truth, everything becomes pure to those whose hearts have been purified and those who have been made pure. So here we go. So raising from the dead is the resurrection, because we were all a bunch of exiles. We got booted out into our suits of death, which is the flesh body. The host body system is death. And then in order to be born again, you have to, ready? You have to go from a superhuman angel demon, and I will show that to you one more time. You got to go from superhuman angel demon, since we just saw the tattoo, Ephesians 2. So we just saw a tattoo of a guy that had a superhuman angel demon. The spirit, superhuman angel demon, see right there? We just saw a guy with a tattoo of one of those. A superhuman angel demon, and it's a sheep, okay? That's the spirit that works in the children of disobedience that fulfilled the desires of the flesh and were by nature children of wrath. See it? So if you have a superhuman angel demon spirit, it just means you haven't been converted yet. And then when you get converted, just like it says in the book of John, John chapter 3, verily I say unto you, Jesus said, verily I say unto you, except a man be born again, it means to be regenerate. Okay, it means to regenerate. Be delivered of. It means you're delivered of the spirit that's running you into another spirit. Unless you're born again, you cannot see the kingdom of heaven. Look at the word see. What's the word see mean? It means to see, to know, to perceive, to have knowledge of, like Jonathan, to discern clearly, like that guy's tattoo, or like the altar of St. Peter is a big dead sheep I keep showing you 1,000 times, to perceive, see, take hold of. Oh, wow. You cannot see the kingdom of God. Well, do you think that you see that after you die? No. I'm showing it to you right now. Let me show it to you. Let me show you how you see it real quick. Let me show you a couple ways you see the kingdom of God. Let me just pull up an album right here, Female Rival. Here's how you see it. See the big dead sheep altar? Let's click on it with all these guys worshiping it, laying down on their face in front of a big dead sheep, which is a penis, a vagina, and a bunch of semen rolling down the side of a penis and a vagina. Because that's how, see, it's overflowing. Mixed race, led into Babylon, overflow. You know, like all the semen overflowing right there. So here's a big dead sheep. Unless you're born again, you cannot see, you cannot know, you cannot perceive. So how did Jonathan Kleck know the Vatican was a big snake? Well, I was born again. I got born again. I got a new spirit. See, I did have a superhuman angel demon, but then I got born again. And then it says you can see the kingdom of God. And I'm just going to show you a couple more pictures. So see, now I can see the kingdom of God. There it is. Oh, wow, it's a dead sheep. What the hell is going on? It's a dead sheep. Oh, my gosh. Look at this image of the Virgin. Oh, it's a dead sheep. Oh, my gosh. Check it out. There's the eye. Nostril, lips. Oh, my gosh. What the heck's going on here? Kleck has the ability to see what's going on. Oh, wow, the Vatican's a big serpent wearing a crown. Did you know the word basilica means royal abode, which is a palace? Did you know the Vatican is very palatial, right? Did you know basilica means royal abode, palace of the basilisk? Do you know what a basilisk is? Yeah, it's a royal serpent that kills with its breath or with its look. Imagine it stealing your breath. There you go. Okay, which is spirit. Oh, wow. Look at that. Do you know what the word Vatican means? Do you know what Vatican means? Divining serpent. Watch. I will type it in for you. I'll close that and I'll type in. Watch it. So you know. T-I-C-A-N. Means divining serpent. Yep. Latin. Just got to go to Latin, guys. See, here we go. There you go. You know Audience Hall, where the Pope stands right in the mouth of this big snake, right? I mean, this is Audience Hall right here, guys. That's where the Pope stands. That's the eyes of a snake. Eye, and there's the fangs. The word Vatican literally means divining serpent. Vatis means diviner. Can means serpent. Did y'all know that American actually means serpent race? Yeah. A lot of people don't know that. Yep. There you go. Divining serpent. And so let's go to that thing. And oh, wow. I'll just take a serpent right here and I'll just drag its head right over there. Oh, it's a serpent wearing a crown. Look at that. Nice. Oh, so it's all right. Huh. That's so wild, isn't it? So if we take the big dead sheep over here and we put it over here and we just trace around that chair right there. Oh, it's a penis. Wow, that's wild. Why is it a penis? It's shooting a seed out. Oh, what's that seed? It's the crown. Oh, wow. It's the crown the angels are holding. Well, didn't Isaiah say those who try and hide their plans, they turn everything upside down? Wonder what would happen if we turn the altar upside down. Well, let's do that. Let's put it right here. Oh, it makes an X. You know what? That's really interesting. So if we take this one and we put it there, look how it makes an X, like X marks a spot. So we have, now we have the sheep upside down and the upside down sheep. Oh my gosh, I just left the lines drawn in. It's the female reproductive system. No way. Yes, check that out. Wow, let's color it in. Look, we colored it in. It is the female reproductive system. That is so bizarre. The mouth of the serpent is the female reproductive system. That's crazy. It almost kind of looks like the female reproductive system, doesn't it? Weird. So let me get this straight, Kleck. The mouth of the serpent on the inside is, that's the mouth of a serpent. There's the mouth of the serpent. But the altar right there on the middle is a vagina? Yeah, it is. Yeah, that's exactly what it is. Oh. Let's take a look at that. Let's just have a look. Let's see. Wow, that's crazy. So that is the female reader. That's like, this is identical to this. And that's kind of wild. I've seen that before, but different. Wow. That's kind of crazy, isn't it? See, your punishment was you got a host body. And if you don't come to faith and you don't admit your guilt before God, you won't be part of the resurrection, which is why El came to get his children. El came to set the prisoners that were prisoners of war free. We're prisoners of war that are getting set free. You see why Satan doesn't want any of y'all to know the truth? Because Jesus is the truth. How do you see the truth? Well, you got to turn everything the opposite direction. I'll just say that. You're upside down, so turn everything up the right way. And you'll see the truth. That's how it works. Pretty wild, huh? Isn't it wild that in the end of the Bible, we have a bunch of bugs that are going to come out of a pit? Now it's time to talk about this. If A equals B and B equals C, then, oh, I wrote the, then, that's an E and that's an N. Sorry about my writing. There you go. If A equals B and B equals C, then A is equal to C because, you know, they're all the same, right? Okay, let me get out my marker. This is going to be fun. I love destroying Satan's kingdom. Nothing like it. I enjoy it. I have to admit, I really do. I enjoy it. I'm not going to lie. It's pretty great. We're going to watch that. We already did that. We're going to see that. And I'll shrink that back down a little bit. There we go. This is such a joke, this video. The Spice Girl is a two-begum one. Check out her hairdo. Tell me it's not a scorpion. Tell me her hairdo is not a scorpion. See, cut like that for like the claws and then the tail. Yeah, no, that's not a scorpion. And that's why she goes and the two become one. Scorpion stinger at you. That was a sting of death. Oh, death, where is thy sting? Oh, like 7-Up. Anyway, we'll get to that in a minute. Let me stay on task. Let's do Revelation. There we go. Oh, here we go. We're right here. Okay, so let's read Revelation. Okay, so the resurrection, which is what today is all about, the resurrection, the raising again from the dead, because we're part of the system that's the dead. The host body system is dead. You're dead in your trespasses and sins. So you got to get born again. You got to get born of the Spirit. Uh-oh. Got to show you one thing and forgot. Okay, so verily I say unto you, except a man be born again of water and the Spirit, he cannot enter into the kingdom of God. Look at the word Spirit here. I'm sorry, I forgot Ephesians 2. Ephesians 2 says superhuman angel demon. But when you're born again, you're no longer a superhuman and angel demon. I'm going to block that out with red. That's gone now. Boom. So the superhuman angel demon is gone. Then you get divine God, Christ, Holy Spirit. And I'm going to make that another color, which is going to be really noticeable. So when you get born again, you become divine God, Christ, Holy Spirit. See, that's how you enter into eternal life. And today's Resurrection Day. Today we're celebrating Christ resurrecting out of the grave, the belly of the earth. He broke down the gates of hell. So the enemy can no longer have hold over you. You see how everything's perfect, don't you? Okay, well, let me just show you. Watch this. So we get born. We were a superhuman angel demon, just like the guy's tattoo. The whole thing's a sheep. The whole thing's a heart, right? There's an angel and a demon that are yoked together in that tattoo. They're yoked together in the tattoo. I'll show you the yoke. There it is. Let me show you the way. Yep. I know I'm jumping around a little bit, but let me show you that. They're yoked together. Watch. You see this? You see this? You see the thing? They're yoked. That line goes under his wing. He's yoked together with the demon. Angel, here's the link. Linked, yoked to a demon. Just like the cross of Christ. One side was evil, one side was good. Jesus reaches out to both sides. So this is a perfect tattoo. This guy's tattoo is really good. There's a demon yoked. You can pick that as the demon or that one. I don't care. A demon yoked to an angel. Okay, so now let's go to Revelation. Okay, Revelation. That great dragon was cast out. I'm sorry. Back down here. Superhuman and angel demon. That goes away, and then you become divine God, Christ, Holy Spirit. Now, let me go back to Revelation. So now, let me do the transitive property. Sorry, I jumped around, kind of lost my place. Here we go. Let's get back to this. If A equals B and B equals C, then obviously A equals C as well. Okay? So, let's do this. Ready? Let's do the same thing here. So, dragon was cast out. Okay, so dragon equals great dragon was cast out, that old serpent equals serpent. Because this is going to be important because y'all need to know what's coming. And at the end of this video, you're going to know what's coming. I guarantee it. So dragon equals serpent, right? It says it right there. That dragon was cast out, that old serpent called the devil. Well, did you know the Vatican is a big serpent in the other direction? The whole building's a dragon. So the serpent, which is called the devil. So now we know the dragon is the serpent and it's called the devil and Satan. So dragon equals serpent. Dragon equals devil equals Satan. So they're all the same, aren't they? Dragon equals serpent, dragon equals devil, dragon equals Satan. Okay, and so he was cast out. They're all the same. So the dragon was cast out, that old serpent. So they're saying that who's that old serpent? The dragon, that old serpent. What's he called? He's called the devil and Satan, which deceived the whole world. He was cast out. He was cast out into the earth, and his angels were cast out with him. Okay, so we can't argue that, right? That's exactly what it says, right? Now let me show you Revelation 9, because this is where everything's going. This is what I've been called to show you. And now we're going to bust into, right after I show you this, we're going to bust into all the horrifying stuff that's coming. Okay, so here we go. Check it out. So now let's look at Revelation and let's read this for a sec. So we know that an angel opens the bottomless pit and there arose smoke out of the pit and out of the smoke and there came out of the smoke locusts upon the earth and unto them was given power as scorpions of the earth have power. And it was commanded that they should not hurt the grass or any green thing, but only those men that have not the seal of God in their foreheads. So that's going to be one scary day. Have you ever thought about it? I mean, you know, think about if you're here and you get to see that. So the earth is going to literally birth. The earth is going to crack open. And once it cracks open, everything from the bottomless pit gets to come out. Well, what's down there? A bunch of locusts. No, well, let's call them scorpions. I could care less how they fly. I care about what they could do to me. You know, I mean, all kinds of bugs fly around. Who cares? But if they fly and they sting, that's a whole different deal, man. That's not good. So they're going to come out, and it was given that they should not kill them, but they should be tormented 5 months. And their torment was the torment of a scorpion when he striketh the man. So how does a scorpion attack? It strikes. In those days, men shall seek death and shall not find it, shall desire to die, and death will flee from them. So you're incapacitated. Any man that wants to kill himself, I don't care who you are, you want to kill yourself, it's easy to do. Get a gun. Jump off a bridge. Step off a curb in front of a bus. You know, get creative. But the point is, you won't be able to get creative because you'll desire to die and death will flee from you. You'll seek death and you will not find it because you're going to be zombified. That's why. You're going to be incapacitated or whatever stung you, that divine impulse that smacked you, is probably going to be converting you like the alien movies into one of them. That's why you're not. It's not going to kill you. It's going to transmute you more than likely. And the shapes of locusts were like horses prepared unto battle. On their heads were as crowns of gold, and their faces were the faces of men. And they had the hair as the hair of women. Well, I'm going to go back to this album and just see. I believe we have some pictures of those locusts. There we go. There is the Vatican. The Vatican means divining serpent. And in the divining serpent is a thing called the list of popes. It's this big thing right here over to the left. And there's a guy that's in a slave collar. That represents one of God's angels. And the Lord told me, now, if somebody wants to argue with me, that's okay. I'm just telling you the way it happened. I heard the Lord tell me, Jonathan, blow that up into a poster and draw on every single line. I was like, what? Draw on all the lines. Changes of shadow. Let me give you a scripture. Every good and perfect gift comes from above, from the creator of heavenly lights, not like them who cast shifting shadows. So what I'm doing is I'm just exercising a spiritual gift where I draw on the lines, the shadows, and then I take on the mind of whoever did that original piece, and I can see exactly what they were thinking. Because it's a supernatural gift. It's what the Lord told me to do. So check it out. So I drew in all these lines, and as I drew them, I was drawing in this part right here. Look at that. That's really interesting. Let me show you something. Look at the way this moves. Look at the way this moves. I'm like, what the hell? And I'm like, oh my God, you know where I've seen that movement before? When one of my kids was born. I'm like, that's a freaking umbilical cord. What the hell? And the Lord is like, that's correct. You're right. It is. And then I saw another one. I'm like, what the hell? It's another umbilical cord. Oh my Lord, that's a fetus. Oh my Lord, that's a fetus. And then I'm like, oh my God, that slave collar is a beast with its mouth open. There's the eye, there's the eye, there's the nose, there's the fang, there's the open mouth. So the slave collar is a beast, and there's a fetus, and there is a fetus. And I'm like, what is this thing on this guy's head right here? That's not how my forehead looks. And I'm like, what? So I just draw in the changes of shadow. I just draw it all in. And then the Bible says those who try and hide their plans, they turn everything upside down. So their plans are get you in a host body, and that turns you upside down. Well, who is they? Well, if we turn it upside down, we're going to get to see who they is right now. Let's do it. Let's turn this whole thing upside down even after. Okay, I'll draw on a line. All lines are being drawn. Okay, so Johnny drew in all the lines, and I'll do a little coloring for you so you can see. So see, look at all those lines I drew in. Oh my gosh. And then I colored it so you could see. Look at that slave collar. It's a beast. Oh my gosh. That's a gnarly ass beast. Sorry. That is really gnarly. Look at that thing with its fangs, its mouth open. And then look at this guy's in agony, and then those were those things on his forehead. And I just color coded it for you. Now let's turn it upside down and see what the beast, which is us, let's see what we become. So if we turn it upside down right now, which I'm going to do right now. So boop, boop, put it right there, turn it upside down. And what seems to happen? Oh my gosh, it's a locust coming out of the pit. Wait a minute. They had the faces of men. Well, that guy had a face of a man. Crowns like gold. That guy's got a crown. I can show it to you. They had hair like women and teeth like lions. Wait a minute. That's crazy. That looks just like, look at those big mandibles, teeth like lions. He has a face like a man, but it's upside down. Look at the hair. By the way, the teeth right there, I just got to color it gold. It makes a crown. I'm going to show you that on some clothing in a minute. And it makes a crown. Look, it's like Ariana Grande's hair coming out of like one of those genie things, you know, where you do your hair like a genie. Let's see. Let's do Google Images real quick. I'll show you real quick. Just Google Images. Ariana Grande genie hairdo, whatever. There you go. Let's see. Like that. Kind of like that. There you go. Kind of like that. There you go. See that? Just like that. That's why she does it. So let's go back and look. Nope, wrong one. There you go. Yeah, so it comes out the top and then it all goes down. So, but then the hair becomes the wind washing under the wings of the locust that's coming out of this dimension from the twin system. Because the twin system produced a locust. It was an angel in a slave collar that turned an angel into a beast, because the host body system is a beast. Yeah. And we're the beast. Look in the mirror if you want to see the beast. We're the beast. And the beast will be unleashed when you take off the collar and that spiritual thing has just, when the restrainer is taken out of the way, and then everybody's going to be either kill or be killed, because they're not going to care. They're going to want to survive because they haven't overcome death. So all they're going to care about is them living, their kids living, and even if it means killing you to do it, they don't care because they're a beast. So there it is. So that's what's coming out of the pit. Isn't it fascinating that's the image? And I'm going to hold on to this. Isn't it fascinating that there's the list of popes and the image that's right there is this thing I'm showing you upside down right there? Look at that. That is a wicked image. Look at that thing. What the hell? That is uber creepy. Look at that. Let's check that out. Look how uber creepy that is. Look at this thing. And see, these are the big wings of the locust coming out of the pit. They're the wings. There's the fetuses. Oh, my gosh. I wish I could get this in super high. I mean, this would be so easy just to destroy drawing all this in. But look at that. That's like the devil. Look at the devil with the big horns. That's what's on the list of popes? That's kind of weird. Well, wait a minute, but remember, we already did our due diligence with the transitive property. Dragon equals serpent, dragon equals devil, dragon equals Satan. So these guys, their building is a serpent. So the serpent is the building that this is in, that I'm showing you right now. So it's no big deal that this big thing is the devil, because the devil is the serpent. The devil is Satan. The devil is the dragon. They are all one and the same. But let's concentrate on this bug thing going on right now, because this is going to be the problem that's coming. We have in Revelation that we're going to see these locusts, which I just showed you one in the Vatican, and it meets the description exactly. Had a hair like women, had teeth like lions. I can show you the crown of gold. It's the teeth. It's a crown of gold. And the faces are faces of men. Just turn it upside down. Hair like women's got it. Teeth like lions, just like mandibles. Breastplates, as it were, breastplates of iron. And the sound of their wings. And the sound of their wings. Well, there's its wings right there. And you can see all the air moving. So it's making a lot of noise, even in the picture I'm showing you. And the sound of their wings was like the sound of chariots, of many horses rushing in the battle. And they had tails like unto scorpions, and the stings were in their tails, and the power of hurt men 5 months. And here it is. They had a king over them. Okay, this is where everybody really needs to pay attention. Who had a king over them? The scorpions. Everything I just described. Let me show you a picture of who has a king over them. So here's the picture. So this thing has a king over them. It has faces of men. If I color that teeth as gold, that would be a gold crown. So it had teeth like lions, like, see those big mandibles? Teeth like lions, face like men, hair like women, crown like good colored teeth in gold. I've already done it. And wings. So here is the exact representation of what's coming out of the pit. Wow. That's crazy. That's insane, as a matter of fact. Well, let's go back and see what it says. The scorpions, they had tails like unto scorpions. And so the scorpions have a king over them, which is the angel of the bottomless pit, whose name in Hebrew tongue is Abaddon. Okay, I'm not worried about that. I know what Abaddon means, place of destruction, death. But what about the name in Greek tongue? It has a name, Apollyon. See right there? His name is Apollyon. So the angel of the bottomless pit, his name is Apollyon, right there. So the king, which is the angel of the bottomless pit, the king that is the angel of the bottomless pit, his name is Apollyon. And Apollyon is the king of the locusts, or the scorpions. Let's call them the scorpions. I like scorpions better. So, I'm going to write this down for you. Sorry, guys. Okay, sorry. Believe me, I'm not, forgive me, I don't mean to be condescending. I'm just meaning, like, I'm just going to make sure everybody gets this. Ready? Apollyon equals scorpion king. Is that correct or not correct? Apollyon, well, it says they had a king over them. Who did? The scorpions that are going to come out and sting men that don't have the seal of God. So, see, they had a king over them, which is the angel of the bottomless pit, whose name is Apollyon. Well, let me show you who that is. So let's go to Revelation chapter 9. Okay, ready? They had a king over them, which is the angel of the bottomless pit, whose name is Apollyon. See right there, Apollyon? Satan! Oh my gosh, you're kidding me. Satan's Apollyon? No, I'm not kidding. See, that is Satan. So Satan, see right here. And they had a king over them, which is the angel of the bottomless pit. In Hebrew tongue is the name Abaddon, which means a destroying angel, from H11, which means to perish, which they hide in all their symbology right in front of you, which is the angel of the bottomless pit. And Greek tongue has a name Satan. So his name is Satan. So what is the name of the angel from the bottomless pit that's going to lead all the locusts, all the bugs that are coming out? Satan equals scorpion leader. Well, isn't Satan all about the flesh? See, Satanism literally is do as thou wilt. The flesh. It's all about the flesh. That's what it's all about. So we know that Satan is the leader of the scorpions now from the pit. So the angel that's going to come out of the pit with all the scorpions is Satan. And this is what we got saved from. And this is what Resurrection Day is all about. Because we got carried away captive into a mixed race land of confusion. Babylon means mixed race. We were made naked, clothed with nakedness, which is your host body. And unless you get born again, because you have a supernatural angel demon running you, unless you get converted and born again and you get Christ's Holy Spirit, you get made divine again, then you just become food for one of those locusts in the pit. And they're coming out. And that's what I'm here to warn everybody about. Now, we're at an hour and 49 minutes. Now, there's a lot of stuff that happened today. I'd like to show you the way that they show you in movies real quick, how they're all around you. They just do this just to make fun of you. Now, remember what this guy said in this one. What's going on here? Well, I believe what was one race is now two. Let's listen.
Can you tell me what's happening here?
Well, my sources are no longer fully annotated and my information is somewhat anecdotal. But I believe what was once one race is now two. One above and one below. Two distinct species that have evolved.
And how do those below survive?
That is the real question, isn't it?
So he winks his eye. See, he winks his eye, just like Alex. Now, remember I told you I walked into Starbucks and a guy said, "Hey, Johnny, how you doing?" He winked his eye. Psalm 35:19, neither let them that are wrongfully my enemies rejoice over me, neither let them wink with the eye that hate me without a cause. So when Alex was winking at me, I knew he hates me without a cause. And then when he sticks out his tongue, against whom do you sport yourself and stick out your tongue? Are you not the seed of falsehood, children of the adulterer and the whore? So all that means is that Alex was taken captive by that spirit because he was winking his eye, sticking out his tongue, no different than this guy right here, and then he makes the sound of a sheep. Now let me show you real quick what Alex did, the guy in Starbucks, when after I walked in there and I told Chris, the manager, I said, "Chris, I'll bet you $1 million that Alex draws a picture of me, and when he does, he puts an image of a dead sheep on my face." Well, there's the picture Alex drew of me. I mean, I saved it, man. I mean, when I walked into Starbucks a week and a half later, and I saw Alex go, "Hey, Johnny, how you doing?" He did it all the time. I was like, "Hey, what's up, Alex?" And, you know, I had already told Chris, "I'll bet you $1 million. Alex over there draws a picture of me, and when he does, he puts a dead sheep on my face." Let me ask you a question. Who in the hell could call that? Nobody. It was the Holy Spirit doing it. And so a week and a half later, I walk in, and Alex goes, "Hey, Johnny, I drew a picture of you." I was like, "Really? Mind if I see?" He shows it to me. And I'm like, "Oh, wow, check it out, Chris. Alex drew a picture of me." And Chris was like, and I'm like, "Yeah." And so Alex went on break right then. And Chris said, "You're on break." Alex was a barista. Chris was like MOD manager on duty. And Alex walked around the bar and he sat. I said, "Hey, you got a minute, Alex?" He's like, "Yeah, man, yeah." And I said, "Hey, I got a question. I've seen this before," but he's like, "Yeah." And I'm like, "That's a really good picture you drew of me." And so, you know, I'm sitting there holding up the picture right here. I'm holding this picture up saying, "Hey, that's a pretty good picture you drew of me, Alex." He's like, "Yeah, yeah." And I said, "Hey, let me ask you a question. So why'd you put the dead sheep behind my ear? I'm not afraid of them." And when I said, "Why'd you put the dead sheep on my behind my ear?" He went, "Do you know who you're speaking with?" I was like, "Yeah, I think so." Then I jumped up from my seat and ran next door because my son was getting his haircut. And I said, "How long is he going to be in the chair?" And they said, 10 minutes. I said, "Send him next door to Starbucks." And I ran back over there. And when I ran in there, I looked out. And Alex was drawing a picture on the lid of my latte. And I looked up. And he had drawn the all-seeing eye right when I walked back into Starbucks after like being out for maybe 15, 20 seconds max. I literally ran out the door just because my kid was next door. I wanted to continue that conversation with the devil, with Satan. I was like, "Hey, I get to talk to Satan. Cool. What's up?" So anyway, when I walked back in, he was sitting there drawing on the lid of my latte, and I walked up and I looked at him, and he goes and looks at me all evil. And I looked down and I saw what he had done. And I sat down and I said, "Yeah, I know who I'm speaking with." I said, "Do you know who you're speaking with?" Anyway, yes. And I said, "Okay, so then you know I'm a messenger, right?" And he went, "Yes." I said, "All right, so you know what the message is, right?" And he looked really despondent. He looked down at the ground and goes, "Yes." And I went, "Your time is up." I went, "Your time is up." And he just, man, he grabbed that pen so fast off that table. I got my distance. I'm like, "Here it comes. Been in martial arts for a while. Know when it's coming. I saw it coming as soon as I saw the flex. I'm like, here it comes. His veins just went. I was like, oh shit. Here he comes. And so I got enough distance because I knew he was going to try and grab that pin and just go right in my neck. I was ready for it. And so I got my distance and he grabbed the pin, and instead of trying to stab me, he started drawing. He drew a picture. He drew the Kobe Bryant ad about a month and a half before it actually came out. It was one of the craziest things I've ever been. He drew the Attack Fast ad. Yep. So anyway, so there's the picture of me that's no different than this.
Below, survive.
That is the real question, isn't it?
Let's do that again.
That's the real question, isn't it?
Let me try that again.
Two distinct species that have evolved.
And how do those below survive?
That is the real question.
Just like this. So let me show you that picture one more time. I'm sorry it's taking so long to buffer. So I just now just draw it into for your perception so it's a little bit easier to see. So there you go. So see the sheep behind my ear? I just drew it in a little easier for you. I just made it, you know, again, the ability that I've been given to see past the darkness is not natural at all. Supernatural. It all belongs to the Lord. The Lord gave me the eyes. You know, we're all part of the body of Christ. I'm the eyes. I'm able to see. Look at it. Look what you're looking at. Some dude drew a picture of me with a damn dead sheep on me, and I called it because his mannerisms were exactly what the Bible said. That's how I called it. Hey, how you doing? That's all. And then when I called that entity out, and I said, so why'd you put a dead sheep on my face? Do you know who you're speaking with? Then the entity manifested within Alex. And then I sat down and got to have a little chat with Satan in the middle of Starbucks. It's pretty wild. Anyway, I've had several things like that. Pretty wild stuff. So anyway, so there's the movie Time Machine. How do those below ground survive? Wait, now let's watch another clip. Let's watch the part where they say, well, we bred ourselves into caste. Do you know what a caste system is? Like, you know, over in India, there's a caste system. You know, you have caste systems. You know what? Let's look it up. So we bred ourselves into, this guy says, we bred ourselves into castes. Some to be our eyes and ears, some to be our muscles and sinew. Let me just hit the back button on this. Okay, so a caste system, C-A-S-T-E, caste system, okay, is the caste system divides Hindus into four main categories. Brahmins, I can't say that word, Kshatriyas, Vaishyas, and the Shudras. At the top of the hierarchy were the Brahmins, who were mainly teachers and intellectuals. Let's take a look at that. Look at the faces facing opposite directions. That's the same as the Bible says, everlasting chains of darkness, forward and backwards ligaments of the body. So a caste system is, you know, related to a system of hierarchy within the group of people. So some people are considered higher than others. That's a caste system. Okay, well, you know how we have going on right now in the government, this dualistic judiciary system with Hillary Clinton, James Comey, Strzok, McCabe, Brennan, Clapper, Loretta Lynch, Ann Rice, and Barack Obama. Those guys are all walking free on their collusion and their lies and stealing and cheating and killing and, you know, but they're going after Trump with a fake dossier. I mean, it's a joke. It's a joke. That's why they're freaking out now, because they realize they're coming to the end of their rule. Watch this. This guy says we bred ourselves into caste system, and so they run the show above ground. So this guy's below ground. Look at the cherry sitting. Does that look like big black wings? It is, because this represents Satan. And that's why he's sitting at a table that's like a triangle tip, and he's at the tip, like the head of the triangle. And look, his reflection's upside down. Now listen to what he says. Listen to what he says.
So we bred ourselves into castes. Some to be our eyes and ears. Some to be our muscles and sinews.
Oh, you mean you're hunters?
Yes. Bred to be predators. But bred also to be controlled, you see. My caste. Concentrated on expanding our cerebral abilities.
You control their thoughts.
Not just theirs.
Eloy. So it's not enough that you hunt them down like animals.
That's their role here.
To be your food.
Yes.
So, what's their role? Okay, so what did he say? That's their role here? To be your food? How do the ones below ground survive?
And one below. Two distinct species that have evolved.
And how do those below survive?
That is the real question, isn't it?
You're looking at it right now on your screen. You're looking at how the ones below ground survive. You're looking at it on your screen right here.
I don't believe it.
Well, if you don't like the answers, you should avoid asking the questions.
Okay, so here we go. Let's do it again. One more time. Listen.
Oh, we bred ourselves into castes. Some to be our eyes and ears. Some to be our muscles and sinews.
Oh, you mean you're hunters?
Yes. Bred to be predators. But bred also to be controlled, you see.
So, let me just stop. So, hunters, well, where are they hunting? They're not hunting below ground, they're hunting above ground. Because the angel of the bottomless pit is running the above ground host body system, hunting us. Oh, that's why there's clothing lines called Hunted for Dinner. Oh, it disguised as For Hunted, right? So just pay attention. So see, they're hunting us from below using the above ground race to do it. And the way they do that is sin. Don't let anyone get saved. Fill up the churches with false doctrine and false teachers. Don't let the truth come out because the truth is toxic to their system. If you've been turned up, you're an enemy of the state. You are an enemy of the system. Seven up, kill them, destroy those that are up. That's why there's a stinger and poison on it, like a scorpion from the pit. See, this resolves everything, doesn't it? Let's go look at that real quick. Well, you know what? Remember flow? Remember protected by flow since 1937, which means desire, longing for, lust? That's a scorpion stinger with poison. Oh, yeah. That's why we have these clothing lines called four. Let's see. There's seven up. Is that just a seven? Is this some innocuous seven up? Or is it something more sinister, like a stinger with poison coming off the tip? And one right side up and one upside down. Is it something more sinister? Huh. Is Rihanna just got a tattoo on her finger that says, is that just Rihanna going shush? I mean, is that all that is? Or is there some cryptic meaning to it? Is she just going like that? Or does the S and the HHH mean something? Oh, the S means, if you look up S, see, S in the dictionary is the 19th letter of the alphabet. And so she's got an S and she has three H's. Chloe Ferry has an S and three H's. Lindsay Lohan has an S and three H's. And here's a clothing line called Lurking Class, STFU, shut the F up. And they're doing the shush thing, and they got fangs like a cannibal, and it's like shush, because they're above ground hunters, because the S If you look up 19 in the Strong's Concordance, because the Lord gave me their playbook, they're using the Bible. They just pick a number out of the Bible that means a word. They just substitute a number for a letter. So let's see, the number 19 right here, the number 19 means slaughter. See right there? Slaughter. And 888 in Hebrew gematria is Jesus Christ. Slaughter Jesus. Yeah, there it is. See, slaughter Jesus. And if you look up 888 in the Strong's, it's evil thing, evil, wicked. So there you go. I mean, there's Barack Hussein, the Scorpion King Obama. You know, there he is doing it. Again, so look, I want everybody to see this so you know. I'm going to go over this real quick. Because remember, the scorpions that are above ground, they're going to have an above ground king. See, just like the king from heaven came into the system, that was Emmanuel. L with us is L. The same as he walked around in a host body and called people to salvation and brought the truth into the system, did the miracles that no other man did. That was the Lord God. That was L, Emmanuel, come in the flesh. Well, from the other side, they're going to have the Scorpion King walking around, just like Jesus was walking around. They're going to have the Scorpion King walking around. And let me show you, just oddly enough, on Barack Hussein Obama's mother's passport renewal, she wrote, see, Sobarkha, Soebarkh. Well, if you spell it backwards, it's Hakrabeos, Hakrabeos. Well, the Lord showed me how to read their language, so I just broke it down backwards. And if you go backwards, if you go backwards with it, Hakrab is scorpion, and Eos is goddess of the dawn. Look, I'm not making this up. See, let's see. Hakrab is in Hebrew a scorpion, and then Eos is goddess of the dawn. And so who's the enemy of the Lord God? The female rival, the goddess of the dawn. That's the rival of the Lord God, the goddess of the dawn. It's Lucifer. So who do you think that the host body might be for Lucifer? Well, so Barca's on Barack Hussein Obama's passport renewal, and it means scorpion goddess of the dawn. That's kind of unusual. But even more unusual, his name is Barack Obama. And in Luke 10:18, it says, I beheld Satan fall as lightning, Barack, from, the heavens, the heights, Obama, Barack Obama. I mean, you know, it's probably just a coincidence. Don't worry about it. Probably nothing. Anyway, so there you go. See, Sobarkha. You spell it Hakrab, Hakrabeos. And Hakrab is a scorpion, and Eos is goddess of the dawn. Well, that's interesting because I know there's a bunch of scorpions coming out of the pit. And that's pretty interesting that his name actually would reflect that. Let's go back to this guy. So they said they bred themselves into Cass. And how do the ones below ground survive? Meh. Well, you're talking to a guy that's had several times people draw pictures of my face and put a dead sheep on it. You're talking to someone that's had that happen. I can show you the other ones. I save all this stuff. Squirming, Satan, are you squirming yet? Are you? Because I have a message for the angel of the bottomless pit. Your time is up. It's up. Time is up. It's coming. I'm your indictment. Sucks to be you. Sucks to be you. And for all his followers, up. Time's up. Just a little note, a notation for those that like to harass me. Just letting you know. It's all you got to look forward to.
Cast. Concentrated on expanding our cerebral abilities.
Control their thoughts.
Not trust theirs.
Eloy. So it's not enough that you hunt them down like animals.
That's their role here.
To be your food.
Yes. and for those who are suitable to be breeding vessels for our other colonies.
Breeding vessels, nice. Oh, like the Vatican big altar maybe, huh? With all the sperm or semen running down the side. Huh, let's watch.
You see, I'm just one of many.
I'm just one of many? That's on the back of the dollar bill. E pluribus unum. Weird. It's like, what a joke.
I don't understand how you can sit there and speak so coldly about this. Have you not considered the human cost of what it is you're doing?
We all pay a price. Alexander.
Wonder what Alexander means. Let's see, where is this guy's gonna go to his little treasure trove of food?
Don't worry, you're safe. I control them.
I want you to listen very closely right now. Now he starts talking about the food supply. He said, don't worry, I control them. If I didn't, then they would exhaust the food supply in a matter of weeks. Then all of a sudden he goes and pulls out something that's swimming around in a puddle of water. Looks like a sperm. Or is it just me? I think I'm probably obsessed with that stuff.
Without that control, they would exhaust the food.
Are those minnows? Oh, look at the reflection. Look, they would exhaust the food supply. Now, let me ask you a question. Do you think the cameraman knew exactly what photo he was taking or what film he was capturing right there, making sure the second he said food supply, everything's upside down and there's little lighted minnows that look like sperm? Do you know how busted these guys are?
In a matter of months.
Food supply. They're human beings.
Who are you to question 800,000 years of evolution?
Okay, well, there you have it. That was just, yeah. So, isn't that odd that the same exact thing I'm showing you is manifesting in all my folders? That I'm walking into Starbucks and people are drawing pictures of me with dead sheep. I was in my art gallery and some guy walked up named Marcel. He handed me a picture he drew of me with a dead sheep on my head, a goat on the back, and a serpent eating me. Wow, that's the same thing as the Vatican. There's a serpent and the mouth of the serpent is a sheep. I mean, I wonder if that's possible. Let me show it to you. Is that even possible? I mean, you know. So here's the one Alex did. So he's got the dead sheep, and if I draw in another set of lines, it's a serpent eating the sheep. But let me show you this other one that was maybe a, there it is. Here's the one done by Marcel. I still have this one on the wall of my house. I have them all. I save everything. So there is the one. You see the little knot in the wood right there? Look at that. That's a knot in the wood right there. And it looks like a watermark. I was like, look at the nose of the sheep. There's the tongue of the sheep. There's the snoot of the sheep. There's the eye. And you know what? You know why he chose that spot for the eye? Because when an animal dies, water leaks out of the ear. And look at this. This is amazing. I mean, this is freaking amazing. This is me being hunted by another race of beings right here. So look. So there's a dead sheep. There's the eye and the water leaking out of the eye. And then as you go to the back head, see the line right there? That's the eye. That's the eye of a goat. There's the ear going out, ear going out. Horn. And then the way it went around my ear, you can tell right here, he, watch this. He made this line right here, a hoof of the goat. So there's a goat facing one way and a dead sheep facing the other way. And then I was like, what's with the drips right here? Oh, he made a serpent eating me. I mean, you know, you're looking at it. I mean, that's just insane. It's like, what the hell? That's pretty crazy. But you know what's really interesting? This is even most amazing to me. When he gave that to me in 2001, I could not tell what was on it. I thanked him. I was like, oh, thank you very much, you know. He, ole, mira, Jonathan, yo lo hago para ti. And I was like, ole, gracias. That's very nice, you know. Thank you. I thought he was like just being really nice and made me, you know, made me a little drawing because I had a sunglass company. I thought it was just being nice. I wanted to be gracious, and I thanked him for it. But then I got saved in 2002. And when I got saved, I could see that. I was like, it's a good thing he wasn't there. I went looking for him. It's a really good thing he wasn't there. Yeah. And so let me show you. I'm going to draw this in now. So let me draw it in. Boom. So I just drew it in. I just showed it real simply. Now look. So there is a dead sheep on top of my head. He put the eye there with the watermark, the ear, the nose, the tongue. And then look at the goat. There's the eye closed, ear, horn, horn, ear. The nose has a delta symbol on it. Then he went around my ear with the line. Then he made the little cleft in the hoof. As the leg of the... So it's a half sheep, half goat. Then he signed his name like a Mayan Indian in the Three Pyramids of Giza. I was like, what the hell? Let me show you a close-up. Let me show you a close-up of that foot so you can see. He put a line in it so you can see the hoof. It's pretty amazing. I was like, this is just insane. There it is. Look at that. See the line right in the middle? He made a hoof. That's not a sideburn. He made a hoof. That's a goat. So, you know, that's called busted. So now, you know what's really amazing? That's no different than the Vatican. There's a serpent eating me. Look. Where's the serpent? There we go. So he made those drops dripping from my fangs, and he put two drops, and he put a drop here and one, this thing over here, and it's a serpent with its tail wrapped around my neck, and it's eating me, and I'm being consumed by the serpent. I mean, that's some pretty freaky stuff. But you know what's really crazy? I've seen this over and over and over again. This is a card that was given to me by my wife. Right here, I just drew it in. It's a serpent. There's the eye of the serpent. Nose, there's the open mouth. Even the stretchy skin on the mouth. And I'm like, wait a minute. Then, if I rotate it, there's a sheep. Here's it. Look, you see the sheep right here? Okay, ready? There you go. There's the sheep. I'm like, wait a minute. Why is there a serpent eating a sheep? So here's the sheep. I'll take the sheep right here. Look. Dun, 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 dun. There's the sheep. Just cleverly put in the drawing. I'm like, oh my gosh. There's a serpent eating a sheep in a card my wife gave me. The one that lied and ran off and did a bunch of other stuff. I mean, God have mercy on her. So I got a card with the serpent eating the sheep from my wife. I got Marcel that drew a picture of me with a dead sheep and a dead goat with a serpent eating me. I have Alex that did the picture of me from Starbucks. You know, the largest altar in the world. There you go. There's Alex from Starbucks. Serpent eating the sheep. There's a sheep. It's probably nothing. There's a Rolling Stones, Mick Jagger. Sitting on top of a sheep with its tongue sticking out, one eye open, one eye closed, the tongue sticking out. That's a sheep. There's the ear, open eye. Just don't look at the nose of the devil right there. They just incorporate many images into one image. So there's a sheep with its tongue sticking out the side of its mouth. Against whom do you sport yourself, make a wide mouth, and stick out your tongue? Are you not the seed of falsehood? Well, then one way it's a dead sheep, and the other way it's a devil. Huh. I wonder if they did in their video a sound like Time Machine. Let's see. Looking really ladylike because she's not, but listen. Like, didn't she just give me a wave? So you hear a sheep sound, then you see a sheep. Weird. So they have an old man make a sheep sound. And then they show you a sheep with its tongue sticking out. Do you know what Jesus saved you from? Do you know what Resurrection Day is really all about? You are resurrected from the dead. Do you understand how profound it really is to get saved? It's not raising your hand in a church saying, I met Jesus today. Balderdash. It's getting converted and having a supernatural spirit take up residency in you because you are willing to surrender, admit your guilt before God that you deserve the pit because you are part of an insurrection. You got cast down. You got your host body prison suit, which is in opposition to the spirit of the Lord God. And unless you get converted, you go to the pit and you're food for a race of locusts. And I'm here to tell you those locusts are coming out of the pit. I'm a town crier. So, guys, there's so much data here. It's hard for me just to, you know, I mean, there is so much data here. I think what I should do is let this video fly. And then what I should do is I should just make another video for tomorrow with the stuff that happened today in Sri Lanka. I think this video is plenty to digest. I want you to know what the resurrection is really all about. It's a resurrection. The bringing to life again. Resurrection. The bringing to life again. You used to be alive, but now you're dead in your sins in your naked host body that you got because you lost your glorified body and you got trapped into a host body, and which is inherently evil, which Satan owns and runs. He owns it. It's his. He owns the flesh. He's the one that runs the flesh. And so unless you get converted, that's why Jesus said, unless you're born again, you will not see the kingdom of heaven, which is what I've been showing you all this video. Or unless you're born again, you will not enter into the kingdom of God, the kingdom of heaven. You will not see the kingdom of God, and you will not enter into the kingdom of heaven. That's it. So Resurrection Day is a big deal. And the only way you get to go there is you accept the cross and the payment of the cross for all your evil sins that you admit you did yourself. You and your evil twin did them all. Just admit it. Y'all are both in the same host body together. But he doesn't want you to admit it. Your evil twin doesn't. He wants you to shut up. Don't say anything. Let him run the show. Because the twin is run from the bottomless pit. Because the twin is Satan. Does that make sense? Got it, right? Anyway, I'm going to let this fly. It's already 2 hours and 22 minutes. And I'm going to let it go. And I'll post another video tomorrow. God bless. Okay, I'm just kidding. I'm not going to end up. All right. You know what? I forgot something. I want to talk about Grand Junction. Okay, I want everybody to understand something. I am not in charge of the timing. A lot of people keep asking me, when is it? When is it? When is it? Well, I was hoping like second, third weekend in May. That's what I was hoping for. It looks like it's more going to be like maybe the second, third weekend in June. I don't know. I'm not in control of the date. Do you understand? The Lord's in complete control of the date. What I can assure you is I will be able to give you a heads up with probably at least a week to a week and a half advance in time. So anyone that wants to go will know when it's time to go if you want to join it. It will be YouTube live. We're going to YouTube live the whole thing. So if you can't show up, you know, you'll be there with us. We'll be running a YouTube live of what's going on. You know, it's going to be like probably a 1.5 day event to where we let everybody show up the first day and you can see the containers and, you know, or however this thing pans out. I'm not exactly sure how it's going to work, but I know this is what I was told to do. And we'll just take it as it comes. But I've taken very aggressive steps to do what I have to do. I was willing to send off a very hefty down payment to get things started. And I'm still kind of working on all that right now. So I'm trying to get it all done. And it's a heavy burden. And I've got all kinds of other stuff going on at the same time. Trust me. I've got a very heavy load. So anyway, here's the thing. Grand Junction, I'm not really going to talk a whole lot about it until I get closer to knowing. It doesn't look like the third week in May is going to make it. I doubt it. But anyway, so we're probably pushing into May, June. June, who knows? Maybe it'll be July 4th. Who knows? I don't know, but it's coming. We're working towards that end, and the Lord will make it happen according to his will, not mine. Okay? I just want to make sure I ended with that. So you guys have an unbelievable resurrection day and know what it represents. Look what you got saved from. I mean, everybody should be jumping for joy. And then I'll share with you tomorrow the bad stuff that happened today and what their message was towards everybody. Okay? All right. God bless.